فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
باب مرفوعات الاسماء. المرفوعات سبعه وهي الفاعل والمفعول الذي لم يسمى فاعله والمبتدا وخبره واسم كان واسم كان واخواتها.
Why did you say? Well, why did I say واسم؟ Yeah? It's alif al-wasl, you don't pronounce it. If the waw wasn't there, what would you have said, Nakib? But the waw is there, do you say it? One of the biggest mistakes people fall into when they're reading. In al-ujmi, utu, comes from being not knowing to read the words in the Arabic. Generally, this is the biggest common mistake. It's a very bad mistake.
وخبر إن وأخواتها والتابع للمرفوع وهو أربعة أشياء النعت والعطف والتوكيد والبدل.
The author now goes into seven things. If a noun becomes these seven, it's basically marfu. Any of these seven. Are you with me, brothers? Pay attention to this. This is the biggest chapter of Nahu. Grammar, what's the biggest? Isim or fi'l? Isim is the biggest. Why? Look, six came out. It's the biggest. Fi'l, it's not big. It's easy to know it's fi'l. Look how quick we finished it. From here to the ending of the book, we're only doing Asma' now. That's it. Isim, fi'l is finished. Are you with me, brothers? We're now going to be dealing with asma, and that is what you need to focus the most on. The author says that the marfu'at of the asma are seven. Al-fa'il, which is the first. So, for example, fa'il, which is a object, a subject. Ja'a Muhammadun. Muhammad here is a fa'il. The second one is al-maf'ul alladhi lam yusamma fa'ilu. The maf'ul, which is the object in which its subject wasn't mentioned. Its subject wasn't mentioned. For example, fuhimad darsu, the lesson was understood. We don't know who did this action. The subject is hidden here. The maf'ul comes forward and it becomes marfu'. Are you there? Brothers, pay attention. What's it also called? Al-maf'ul alladhi lam yusamma fa'ilu. What do scholars sometimes call it as well? Na'ibu fa'il. What else do they call it? Mabniyu lil-majhul, right? They say that, right? When it comes to the Quran, it's su'ul adab to say mabniyu lil-majhul. Bad manners. Learn this. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, wa khuliqa al-insanu da'ifa. Khuliqa here is what? Al-maf'ul alladhi lam yusamma fa'ilu. But who is the one who created them? Can you say, is Majhul the one who created them? So it's one of the things that when you're learning grammar, what you say in the Quran is different what you would say in a grammar book. You have to have good manners with the Quran and the way you deal with the Quran and the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third and the fourth is Al-Khabar and Mubtada. From a Mubtada Al-Khabar. Mahmoodun Hadirun. Mahmood is present. The fifth one is Ismu Kana wa Akhawatiha. Kana and its sisters. For example, Kana Salihun Rakiban. Salih is Rakib. He's Rakiban, he is what? He's mounted on a riding beast. So Salih here is the Ismu Kana. It's the ismu kana. The sixth is khabaru inna wa akhawatiha. Khabaru inna and its sisters. Which is inna muhammadan qadimun. Qadimun here is the khabar of inna. It's the khabar of inna. Each one we're going to take inshaAllah ta'ala properly. Then the author rahimahullah, he mentions four things that are known as tawabi', and they're called tawabi' means that they follow the sign of what's been spoken about. For example, النعت, characteristics. نعت is characteristics. So if you say جاء محمود, محمود came, and you want to describe who he is, الفاضل, the virtuous one. Virtuous is an attribute, an adjective. Okay? Now pay attention here. الفاضل is got رفع on it, it's مرفوع. Why? Because محمود, who is the subject, the فاعل, it's copied it. It follows it. That's why it's called تابع. And then the second one, which is عطف. And عطف is two types. The عطف is two types. The first one is called عطف نسق. And عطف نسق means it's the عطف which basically is due to, is done with a letter. And it's generally with the letter واو. For example, you say حضر محمد, محمد came, وعلي, and علي. علي here is taking the sign of محمد because it's between them the واو. The واو is عطف. It's the word and. And there's another one called عطف بيان. عطف بيان is ما كان موضحا لما قبله بلا حرف. عطف بيان is anything that clarifies what was before it without any letter. For example, أقسم بالله, he swore by Allah, أبو حفص عمر. عمر. أبو حفص عمر. He swore by Allah. So عمر here is what? مجرور علامة جري الفتحة. لأنه it's ممنوع من الصرف, right? Are you with me, brothers? We'll talk about that all in details. This is an overview. The third type of tawabi' that the author mentioned is tawkeed, emphasis. قَدِمَ مُحَمَّدٌ Muhammad came, نَفْسُهُ, he himself. So, قَدِمَ Muhammad is enough. نَفْسُهُ is what? Himself. Again, good manners with the Qur'an. If I got rid of the word nafsuhu, are you there? Nafsuhu, if I got rid of that, would the sentence change? If I said qadima muhammadun, is that sentence incomplete? No, it's complete. Will the sentence meaning change if I didn't bring the word nafsuhu? No, it won't change. Because it's emphasis, right? Can you say that the Qur'an has emphasis in it, knowing that you can drop a letter and the meaning won't change? Su'ul adab ma'al Qur'an then. Are you with me, brothers? You can't say something in the Qur'an is tawkeed. It has to have extra meaning as well. Are you with me? Ibn al-Qayyim said, قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى فَسَجَدَ الْمَلَائِكَةُ كُلُّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. كُلُّهُمْ, is كُلُّهُمْ الْأَجْمَعِينَ the same? The angels all prostrated, ajma'ina, kulluhum, all of them, ajma'ina, all of them. Is it the same? It's an emphasis, huh? Or should we say it's an emphasis? Can we get rid of ajma'in? So how is it an emphasis then? فسجد الملائكة, the angels prostrated, kulluhum, all of them. أجمعين, all of them. أجمعون. Says أجمعون, right? Yeah? It's أجمعون, sorry. I was testing. أجمعون. It's in Surah Al-Sad, the last, second last page, right? Pay attention here, underlining point. Can we say, فسجد الملائكة, that all angels prostrated, كلهم, all of them. Ajma'una, all of them. So we can take ajma'un out of the ayah. Kulluhum is sufficient. Ibn al-Qayyim came and he said, kulluhum means they all prostrated. Ajma'una means at the same time. Are you with me? خلاص. There's no verse in the Quran you can say it's tawkeed like that. They're just repeating the same meaning. It's emphasizing on a point that was already mentioned. No, it has an extra meaning. I would have to look at what Ibn Qayyim said. صح؟ But لا شك, all I'm putting, I haven't looked at all the emphasis in the Quran that's been mentioned. Abu Bakr said, أَيُّ السَّمَاءِ تَظُلُّنِي وَأَيُّ أَرْضٍ تَقُولُّنِي إِنْ أَنَا قُلْتُ عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا أَعْلَمُ. Which sky is going to shade me? And what land is going to hold me if I say about Allah that which I don't know? So I can't speak about the verse. And I don't want you guys to throw me in mahawin. But what I'm saying is that the qa'idah is what I'm pushing forward. Then we can go to the verses individually and check, is it or not? Are you there? And this is what came to my mind as I was speaking. I remembered it. No, they say tawkeedul ma'a. It's tawkeed, it's an emphasis with this meaning extra. An extra meaning is what they add to it. It's not a normal tawkeed, no. So they add, they say it's got extra meaning in it as well. Ziyadatu ma'na. In the Quran, a letter can't be dropped. Forget a word. Kalima can't be dropped. صح? A letter will be dropped. هكذا أنزل على محمد. That's how it was said. صح? In Surah Al-Bara'ah, for example, صح توبة. Yeah? من تحتها الأنهار. Some of the Quran don't even have me in there. The word is not there. Allah said both. Are you with me? And since he said both, we can say both. But we can't drop a word out and say, oh, I'm an Arab and I think this word can be, we don't really need it, no. It has a meaning. That letter by itself is playing a role. This issue of the preservation of the Quran and the letters and everything. One of the amazement that are in the Qira'at is for Qawlu Ta'ala, for example, يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن جاءكم فاسق بنبأ فتبينوا فتثبتوا. Look at the letters, the way it's written. فتبينوا فتثبتوا. Try to write it. The difference between it is just the dots. صح? The only difference فتبينوا فتثبتوا is the dots. Even the writing are the same. Are you with me? هكذا أنزل على محمد. That's how it's said of him, عليه الصلاة والسلام. This is not ijtihad of the companions and their knowledge of one not. These are the, and it wasn't differences in their masahif and their copies of the Quran. Not at all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said the Quran like this. You know, one thing that the Orientalists don't tend to understand is that, and this is one thing that's very important that the point has to be driven home, is that the Arabs' memorization was profound. It was profound. It was said, Allahu A'lam, it was said that Ubay radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Surah Al-A'raf, it came down one time, فَحَفِظَ مِنْ فِيِّ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. He heard it from the Prophet's mouth once and he memorized it. All of it, قَاطِبَةً. One time, heard it, read. Okay. When he finished it, he read it all. People's like that is what their brain was. They weren't living on chicken and chips and stuff like that, you know? Fresh food. They grabbed it. Even pre-Islamic history, pre-Islamic, what do you call it, poetry. Wallahi al-Azim. The mu'allaqat and the shi'r were done on the spot. Was read. Finished. As soon as it finished, there was a man listening. He'll stand up and he would respond to each of those poetry with a poetry he's just made from the top of his head. And he's basically responding to each point of that poetry. And the other one comes up and he does the same. And their battle was from the top of their memory. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose these people for a reason. So the Quran was memorized. Writing wasn't a condition for them. Rather, when they wrote it, they forgot it. So that's how Allah protected this Quran. Are you there? I just said, kullum ajma'een. What's the difference between ajma'een and ajma'un? I got stopped. Hakada, there's always a place you go to Quran is memorized. It won't, how can this Quran be? If it would ever have been forgotten, is now that the Muslims are distanced from the Book of Allah. It should have been forgotten now. Out of all the times, it could have been forgotten. Now you go to a masjid, you say, little kid, And I'll correct you. صح؟ إنا نحن نزلنا الذكرى وإنا له لحافظون. The Quran is a miracle. جاء النبيون بالآيات فانصرمت وجئتنا بحكيم غير منصرم. آيات كلما طال المدى جدد يبينهن جمال العتق والقدم. Musa came with a miracle, it went with him. Isa came with a miracle, it went with him. Muhammad came with the underlining, strongest miracle there ever be. Quran. Challenge this Quran. Come with the likes of it. Look at it. Observe it. Brothers, know what the mu'jiz of the Quran is? I said this to you guys before, and I think I'm going to say it again. If I speak today, you can't judge me for the opposite of the statement I said. So for example, if I say to Yunus, I really love you, for the sake of Allah, somebody can say, oh, so you're saying that you don't love the rest? That's the same. I'll say, no, I didn't mean that. Are you with me? I did not mean that. I negate that. Allah's kalam, what he said, the mantuq and the mafhum, both of them are dalala. You can use it as evidence. The Quran. That is why the ijaz stands. The mafhum, which is what it's directly saying to you, and what you understood from the verse is a hujjah, you can use it, no problem. Can anyone say that in his speech? So we have, the scholars have to make a principle for the humans. They said, لَازِمُ الْمَذْهَا لَيْسَ بِلَازِمْ حَتَّى يَلْتَزِمَ بِهِ صَاحِبُ. Whatever you necessitate for my speech, don't hold me account for it. Allah? Yeah. Whatever necessitate from his speech, we'll use it as a evidence. صح. That's why they made dalalatul mafhum. صح. Dalalatul mafhum is what we understood from the verse. Like Allah says in the Quran, for example, يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه. So if we differ on a matter, what do? Take it back to them. What about if we don't differ? إجماع happened. دليل. That's a mafhum. صح؟ That shows that the إجماع is a proof. If we don't differ, we're in a state of consent, I can say to you, this is a دليل for إجماع. Are you with me, brothers? هذا دليل إجماع. ما you're not with me. Are you with me, brothers? We can do that with the Quran. The mafhum and everything is a hujjah like that. Are you there, brothers? The fourth one that the author mentioned is for the tawabi' is badal. Badal means something that takes the place of the other. Ja'a Aliyun, Ali came. Akhuka, your brother. Ali and your brother is the same, right? Your brother Ali has come. I will take the types of badal there is, inshaAllah ta'ala, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. All of those four, what are they called? They are all called tawabi'. We're now going to, inshaAllah ta'ala, speak about all of them, all the seven, one after the other. And then we're going to stop there today, inshaAllah ta'ala. After we speak about the marfu'at, each one. So let's start with the first one, hey?
Fa'il. Al-fa'il wal-ismu al-ladhi wal-ismu
al-marfu'u wal-ismu al-marfu'u
al-madhkur qablahu fa'il. Fi'luhu.
Say one more time.
Al-fa'il wal-ismu al-marfu'u al-madhkur qablahu fi'luhu. وهو على قسمين.
تلفون كفوي. واضح. That's what I think.
وهو على قسمين.
The author now goes into الفاعل. And the فاعل is من أوجد الفعل. It's the one who brought about the verb, the action. الفاعل is the subject. It's the one who's doing the action. He's always مرفوع. The author said هو الاسم. It's a noun. المرفوع. We took what the word مرفوع means. المذكور قبله فعله. And before it, the verb is mentioned. This is the order. In English, it's a SVO language, right? Subject, verb, and object, right? English, that's how it is, right? Arabic, no. It's verb, subject, object. That's the order. Okay? So here, that's what the author is telling you. The verb comes first before the subject. That's how it should be. Sometimes it does change. And when it does change, it shows a powerful meaning that comes out of it, which is called hasr. Hasr comes, which is called exclusivity. That's what happened there. The subject was meant to be what? After the verb. But here what happened is تأخير ما حقه التقديم تأخير ما حقه التقديم يفيد الحصر. That's the قاعدة. Anyways, the author here says it's مرفوع. So can it be مجرور? Can a فاعل be مجرور? Can it be منصوب? No. Can it be a فعل? No. Okay, good. All of that we've taken. And it's two types. The fa'il is two types. What are they? The author's going to now tell us. So the first one is dahir. What's dahir? Apparent, huh? Huh? Apparent. هو ما دل على معناه بدون قرينة. هو ما دل على معناه. It's anything that shows its meaning without any hits. Like it doesn't need a قرينة. It doesn't need anything to take its place. When it directly shows its meaning, it's apparent in its meaning. Whereas مضمر ما دل على معناه بقرينة بقرينة, it is, huh? It's three things. It requires three things that you would use in order to what? To get the meaning to across to the people. You're either going to have to use التكلم أو المخاطبة. أو غيبة. So the author, which are the three types of pronouns there is. There's the one that's personally speaking, which is أنا and نحن. Are you with me, brothers? أنا and نحن is المتكلم, the one who's speaking. I and we is you speaking by yourself. And then the one مخاطبة means you're addressing somebody, and that is أنت, أنت, أنتما, أنتم, أنتنا. Five. And then there's the غائبة, which is absent. You're talking about people who are not there. Huwa, hiya, huma, hum, hunna. Five. So altogether it's 12. Five which are mukhataba, you're talking to somebody. And five which is ghaiba. And also two which is al-mutakallim, the person who's talking about himself. So the author is going to tell you that these are basically what the fa'il is. Hiya. So Zayd stood. Zayd is the fa'il here. It's apparent. Hey? And Zayd here is apparent again. And Zayd, the two Zayds are apparent here. Hey? And the two are apparent. So here again, the Zaydun are apparent both times. Hey? It's apparent again, the Rijalu.
Hey?
Hey? Yeah. وقامت الهندان.
وقامت الهندان وتقوم الهندان وقامت الهندان وتقوم الهندات وقامت الهنود وتقوم الهنود وقام أخوك ويقوم أخوك وقام غلامي ويقوم غلامي وما أشبه ذلك.
The author here, what he's basically done is he mentions 10 ظاهر, 10 ظاهر, apparent subject. And the first one he mentioned, which is قام محمد, is مفرد مذكر. It's singular, masculine. And then, so that was قام محمد, and يقوم, I mean, he said قام زيد, right? قام زيد, يقوم زيد, both of those are what? مفرد مذكر. Then the author mentions a مثنى مذكرا. مثنى مذكر, which is قام زيدان يقوم زيدان. Those are what? مثنى مذكر. Then the author رحمه الله mentions جمع مذكر السالم, which is قام زيدون يقوم زيدون. Then the author mentions جمع التكسير from مذكر with a ماضي قام الرجال. And then يقوم الرجال. Then the author mentions a مفرد singular مؤنثا feminine with a ماضي قامت هند and تقوم هند. Then the author mentions أي مثنى مؤنثا, which is feminine, dual feminine, with a ماضي, قامت الهنداني, and with a مضارع, تقوم الهنداني. Then the author mentions جمع مؤنث سالم, قامت الهندات, تقوم الهندات. Imagine the ماضي and the مضارع both. And then the eighth is جمع التكسير لمؤنث. He said قامت الهنود and تقوم الهنود. And the ninth, which we mentioned, is اسم من أسماء الخمسة, قام أخوك ويقوم أخوك, with the ماضي and the مضارع. Each time he was doing a ماضي and a مضارع for it. The tenth, which is the last one, the author rahimahullah, he spoke about that which its إعراب is مقدر. Why? Because لإضافتها بالياء المتكلم, because the ياء المتكلم is connected to it. قام غلامي, which is the ماضي, and the مضارع, which is يقوم غلامي. Those are the 10 which he mentions. So قام غلامي and يقوم غلامي were the last that he mentioned. Are you with me, brothers? We've now finished the when it's apparent. We're now going to go into when it's مضمر pronoun. Right?